distinguished guests from UN and outside the UN organization. Today, we'll take you around to see the consequences of the war on Yemen and to see the vast damage being visited upon Yemen, which is a humanitarian crisis, a political crisis, as well as we'll discuss today a development crisis. The report which we are launching today shows the development in Yemen has driven back by decades. It shows the contrary which a country rich in culture and history, wisdom and humility fading into pieces. It reminded us that the linkage or the links between peace, security and development are too often more honored in the breach than of the others. This is a timely discussion at the time when people of Yemen are really in need of help, and I'll try to welcome my colleague Sarah, because before doing that one, I'll try to note it, the partnership between UNDP Yemen as well as with PADI, the University of Denver. Please allow me to welcome Sarah Cliff, Director of New York of Center of International Cooperation at the University of New York, to take over this event today. However, before we start, we have a short video of 2 minutes that will allow to show it to you. We do believe that the picture can tell thousands of words than what we can say over to you. Just to remind you all, this event is live streamed.
After a video like that. So this is a war that has caused unprecedented human suffering, among the highest toll, indeed the highest toll that we have seen in the last half of the 20th century, which was in itself a very bloody time. It has caused huge social, economic, and institutional losses, and it has not received the international attention and pressure to stop the war that the people of Yemen deserve. So this panel and our seminar this afternoon is an opportunity to find out more about what has been happening in Yemen. But it is also, I hope, an opportunity to brainstorm and to think about what are the actions in this very difficult environment that can be taken to protect the Yemeni people. And we do know that despite the devastation we just saw on the video, Yemen has been a place where we have seen a fairly unprecedented degree of cooperation between, for instance, the UN's political arm, Special Representative of the Secretary General, the development system, the World Bank and the UN, trying to find some very creative ways to deliver to the Yemeni people in a situation of hot conflict. And I hope that we will have an opportunity to talk about some of those today. I'm grateful, of course, to the Japan Society, to the government of Germany, and to UNDP for drawing together this event. And I would like, without further ado, to turn over to UNDP Administrator, Mr. Hansen.
Thank you very much. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to what will not be one of the happiest moments during this General Assembly Week, because indeed, as we have already seen, as I'm sure many of you know who are here in this room today, we are bearing witness to something that much of the world has not realized, quite how catastrophic and quite how acute the situation is. We know that war is horrible. We know that war kills. We know that war destroys. But in few cases in our lives right now, is there a country that is so fundamentally affected by conflict as we see in Yemen? A few weeks ago, I traveled to Yemen and I visited both Aden and Sana'a, but also the port city of Hodeidah. And you know, when you spend almost 5 days in a country, you have really seen nothing. And yet, I felt like I have seen a whole library of horror movies. Because what I saw there is not even something that you can necessarily pinpoint on the physical destruction, which you kind of witness everywhere. But destruction as a result of attacks and bombings and fighting, yes, that's one thing. But what a collapse of infrastructure. The sheer despair that you see in the way that people just are sitting in the street, looking at life passing them by. That was a thought that struck me at the time. And not that they're passive, but there is simply is this sense of not being able to change something that is completely beyond their control. In part, we wanted to have this meeting here because we want to be part of not only bearing witness, but to actively bring to the attention of the international community that what is playing out in Yemen today is not just something that has to do with Yemen, and we all know that very well. And therefore, when the world meets here in New York at the UN General Assembly, Yemen belongs also on the agenda here. And it belongs on the attention of every single country that claims to believe in multilateralism and in the core mission of the United Nations, which begins with this whole notion of peace. And it is the Secretary General who, very much with the Stockholm Agreement, sought to bring to the conflict in Yemen and about Yemen a window of opportunity. And I think it is important as we look, particularly with the report this afternoon, at the cost to development in Yemen, that we do so in the broader context, first of all, of the political, the peace and security efforts that are underway right now. Because whatever we will do, whatever we will be able to rationalize in terms of interventions, support, rehabilitation, reconstruction, in the end, its success will largely be defined by whether peace and security efforts actually succeed. So this is not, in a sense, to weigh one against the other, but to recognize that it is precisely precisely in the interplay of, first of all, the peace, security, political efforts. Secondly, the humanitarian response that right now is so fundamental to so many Yemeni citizens to even survive. And I'm glad that a number of my colleagues from the UN family are here this afternoon, who are really at the forefront of this humanitarian effort, alongside with the brave NGOs and civil society organizations that continue to work in Yemen. And then, yes, also those of us who believe that development is not something that comes when war is over. And the reason why this report, why the work with the University of Yemen, why the collaboration with our colleagues in the Pali Institute is so relevant, is that we have learned time and again that dealing with conflict is not something that lends itself to being put into a sort of chronology. Well, first you have politics and peace and security, meanwhile you do humanitarian efforts, and then, you know, when everything is all right, development starts again. In too many instances, first of all, we missed an opportunity with the so-called development interventions to perhaps facilitate, accelerate the political peace and security process. Secondly, we also miss opportunities with the humanitarian efforts to actually leverage that humanitarian effort in order to maintain what, you know, development economists then call capital, whether human capital, financial capital, the infrastructure capital of a nation. And I think this is also at the heart of something that we have often discussed in many different arenas about the humanitarian development nexus. We give these things great names, but it is actually in Yemen that this plays out and that you can either see it succeed or fail. I must say, I was very impressed by two phenomena that I saw in my visit there. First of all, the degree to which the humanitarian and the development actors and the political and peace security process are interacting and leveraging of one another is visible. It's palpable, it's happening, and I think, if anything, we should encourage our colleagues, the institutions involved, to do more of that. Because at least, out of this bitter contest that we're working in, some very positive lessons may emerge. Secondly, I was also struck by the way in which, particularly when it comes to development interventions, we're actually maintaining something that, if that is lost, then Yemen has lost almost the backbone of its developmental capacity. And this is not just now talking about what is happening in terms of what the reports, both the earlier one and this one, demonstrate, that we are essentially not eradicating poverty, we're actually impoverishing a nation. We're impoverishing an entire generation, and we're throwing a country back by two decades or more. In fact, in the report, there is one scenario by which Yemen by 2030 would have become, and I change that word, it would have been made into the poorest country on the planet. What a cynical scenario to play out in a way. But this is the reality against which we are having our discussions in the political arena, in the Security Council, in our agencies, our boards, in capitals, and we are still watching a conflict play out that ultimately is throwing an entire generation, but also an entire nation, back by decades. In trying to counter that, we have also embarked on some very innovative partnerships. And I see Annette here, and with the World Bank also, I think both UNICEF, UNHCR, WFP, UNDP, and the bank, we have broken some new ground in trying to figure out how do we not just keep people alive, which is the first and absolutely immediate priority, but in so doing, how do we also keep some of that alive that allows a country to first of all still function, even if only at a minimum operation level? But also, how do we make it easier when one day the bombing ceases and the fighting stops, for a country to be able to draw at least on the remnants of institutional and human capital in order to recover? This is part of what we wanted to bring to the center of our attention here, because I saw it, I went to the data, and I truly believe that the work that Martin Griffith is trying to do will in part be more likely to succeed, or perhaps less likely to succeed, because of our ability to quickly find a way to rehabilitate the port infrastructure in Madeira, so that this lifeline becomes one that demonstrate to people and to many others that this is not just a war economy in which a few people are becoming very rich, but actually the rest of the country is paying the price for not even having a basic functional port infrastructure. And Albert and colleagues could speak to the sheer logistical challenge of trying to repair some cranes in a country that is in the midst of a war. And maybe you will do so after later, just to give a practical illustration, because it may seem so simple. Repairing a few cranes to unload ships can't be that difficult. Well, even that in Yemen right now is verging on the impossible. Equally, what I was fascinated by, and I have to admit right now because I rushed from one meeting to another, that I cannot remember the two partners with whom we worked so closely and with whom we met also in Sana, Social Development Fund, and the Public Works Project, forgive me, because actually I found these partners extremely impressive. These are two institutions that also the bank has been very critical and central in the past to help develop, who are there and who are able to work across the whole country. They are Yemeni institutions. They are part of that institutional infrastructure that is there, and with whom we're able to do things that build off the humanitarian efforts, but right now are actually also reinvesting in restoring sometimes the things that will keep people alive. And in the report you will find a number of examples, and I will not dwell further on this, that also pinpoint the sectors in which right now doing something that we might classified as being somewhere between humanitarian support and development support, actually is immediately about saving lives, because cholera, and Lisa, you are sitting here as our resident coordinator, you have often spoken about it, cholera is not an accident. Cholera is a product of basically human failure to control the drivers that cause it. And right now, water and sanitation is one of the areas that lends itself immediately to both, in an absolute sense, reduce the cholera threat, but also rebuild infrastructure, and as I saw in Ireland, but also in Sana and Hodeida, to work with people, to engage them again, to give them some hope, some revenue, some income, and enable them to actually rebuild some of their infrastructure that will reduce the risk to them in the immediate sense, restore some pride, generate some income, and allow them actually to have the power to even buy the next meal rather than having to hope that somebody will bring them the next meal. This is the reality in which Yemen is currently struggling to not only gain the attention of the international community, but also perhaps to remind those who are involved in this conflict that the price that people are paying is one that no one can justify. And I hope that by bringing this to the fore also through the work that we have done here together and are presenting to you, we'll make the chances for peace a little bit higher and the cost of ignoring the impact of war a little bit tougher. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Administrator. I think that you drew attention very, very clearly to the necessity to be very creative, to find any manner that we can do to cooperate in protecting the people and the institutions and social fabric of Yemen during this tragedy, which, as you said, was made, not became. You also pointed to the interplay of political, security, economic, and humanitarian factors. And it's my pleasure to ask Ambassador Jürgen Schultz to give some welcome remarks. Germany, of course, plays a role as a Security Council member, as well as a supporter of humanitarian and development assistance.
Well, Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, dear friends, delighted to welcome you here today at this important event and at this very critical time for Yemen. And let me first of all particularly welcome His Excellency Mr. Mohammed Al-Harami, Foreign Minister of Yemen, who is with us today to discuss the latest developments. We've gathered today, I think Steiner has said it already, for the launch of the latest report in the UNDP series, Impact of War. I'm sure most of you are familiar with this. And I want to say that this report basically highlights two things. First of all, the detrimental effect the war in Yemen has already had on Yemen. But secondly, it also outlines the severe consequences will have shut the conflict right on. And I want to commend UNDP and the administrator from Stein and all his team, as well as the Prodi Center of the University of Denver, for compiling this report with its insightful analysis. We have a clear motto here that we have already seen: Yemen cannot wait. And I think that's very relevant. As the special envoy of the Secretary General for Yemen, Martin Griffith, also made very clear during his last briefing to the Security Council, that Yemen cannot wait because it cannot afford to wait. The war continues, the existence of Yemen itself as a state, as a country is at stake. And the report shows us that Yemen has no time to spare indeed. The war must end now if we do not wish to see a whole generation lost of others, at least what Rappenstein also just referred to. We're all aware of the many, many complex and critical points that have to be solved in Yemen. Just to highlight three out of so many. First of all, the recent and worrying attacks on oil facilities in Saudi Arabia that, of course, have led to a much broader debate what consequences this conflict entails. Secondly, the fighting which has spread throughout the entire country and recently culminated in attacks on government institutions also in the south. And thirdly, of course, also the very fragile situation in Hodeida. We all hope that the Stockholm Agreement would take the example of Hodeida as a confidence-building measure and from there on produce some first good results that then could lead to the resolution of the conflict at large. Unfortunately, we're not quite there yet. All this reveals the vulnerability and the complexity of the conflict that is taking place in an already very, very volatile region. And while many parties are involved in this brutal war, the party that suffers the most and bears the brunt of the war is very clearly to be identified. It's the Yemeni people. The human suffering in Yemen has never been worse, and every day innocent civilians, often women and children, are killed by or die from the consequences of this war. And the report shows what will happen if the fighting persists. It also shows how Yemen and Yemenis more than ever need our strong support and commitment. And in that context, let me also commend the tireless efforts of the entire UN humanitarian team under the leadership of the President Coordinator, Ms. Grande, who is with us today. But also, let me mention the ICRC, UNDP, with Peter Montaigne and all the humanitarian actors, national and international on the ground. Their invaluable work under exceptionally difficult circumstances saves hundreds of lives every day and remains indispensable in preventing the war. However, without a political solution, we will see Yemen disappear right before our eyes. That's the danger that we're facing. And that's why there's no alternative to the efforts, the political efforts, by the special envoy Martin Griffith, other actors to advance a political process. That's what we need, and we all know that, and all actors are involved know that. But they're still not there, and we all know the reasons for that. We need a process that must be inclusive, including all sides, all relevant actors, including women, youth, civil society, as well as the different regional groups, obviously. We all need to work towards a prosperous future for Yemen, which is going to live in peace. Now, Germany is trying to play its part. We have been trying to be a reliable partner and friend to Europe for decades, and we will remain committed to a comprehensive approach by providing humanitarian assistance. This year alone, we contributed over $140 million by stabilization efforts, development cooperation, track two dialogues, and last but not least, and maybe most importantly, our strong political support. Actors as well as the people in Yemen must understand that peace will pay off. And that's why we're also engaged in promoting the peace support facility set up by the Israeli team. As I said already in the beginning, Yemen and its people cannot wait. And I'm glad
messages, and then we'll hear from Foreign Minister Al-Hadrami in terms of the
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'd like to thank our UN organization colleagues for their extensive support in the writing of this research and the collaboration around the background work in this space as well. So thank you all so much. Thank you as well to the Germans for supporting this and for this great facility as well. So my name is Jonathan Moore. I'm the lead author on these reports, and I'm the director of the Frederick Hardy Center for International Futures at the University of Bentley. This is the second report that we produced that we're launching today that explores the impact of conflict on development in Yemen. Before I go too far down this path, I want to introduce two of my co-authors to the audience here so that after the event ends, if you have additional questions, you can speak with them. So in the back, we have Taylor Hanna, if Taylor can raise her hand, and then Dave Bowl is also here. I don't know if Dave is. Dave's in the back on the right as well. So, without further ado, I'm going to get into the substance and the findings of the report. So prior to conflict escalation in Yemen in March of 2015, Yemen had not met any of the Millennium Development Goals and was not on pace to meet any of the Sustainable Development Goals. That's prior to escalation. When conflict escalation occurred, it set back human development significantly, destroyed fragile infrastructure, livelihoods, and lives, and fundamentally changed the future development trajectory of the country. These are the findings that I'll be unpacking today in this presentation. So why is the conflict in Yemen so particularly destructive? There are three main factors that we would highlight. One factor is that prior to the conflict, Yemen was kind of multidimensionally fragile in any case, in terms of governance institutions, levels of development, etc. There was also an incredibly high dependence on food imports for consumption, which creates a broad vulnerability for the country in terms of humanitarian crises that can escalate into broad development crises as well. And then thirdly, there are few options for emigration for most people. So many of the people remain trapped in a conflict zone with very high dependence on the outside for food imports and broadly fragile institutions. So the presentation today is going to start with the methodology. That's never really the most interesting thing to start with, but I think it's an important thing for us to kind of get our heads around a bit. So the methodology that we developed for this study uses a tool called the International Futures Tool. The visualization that you have here represents the different systems that the tool covers. We've used this tool in studies with UNDP, UN Environment Program, and other broad international institutions as well. The tool allows users to go in and explore development trends across these connected issue areas for 186 countries around the world. The tool is free, it's open source, we're an academic institution. The tool has been developed over a 40-year period, so this is the 41st year of development. So it's not something that we just created quickly. For this report, it's a large quantitative platform that we modified in order to be able to assess the developmental impacts of conflict in Yemen. I meant to reference this visualization. My apologies. This visualization represents the different broad issue areas that the International Futures Tool represents. So broadly, we're trying to simulate how development unfolds within countries across time. For this study in particular, we've used a methodology where we are comparing different scenarios that simulate development in Yemen. So this is a visualization to represent that. Our scenarios are the same in 2014, that's considered our base year, and they extend out to 2030, the Sustainable Development Goal time horizon. We use data that we gather from other organizations to calibrate the model in order to create a conflict 2030 scenario. So this is a scenario that simulates how conflict has unfolded in Yemen across these multiple dimensions that I've been describing. And then we project that development out to 2030. We compare that with a scenario where conflict in Yemen did not escalate starting in 2015, where conflict in Yemen kind of went away. So what would Yemen have looked like in that development scenario versus what does Yemen look like now through 2019 and then our projection through 2030. We compare these two scenarios to capture something very important. It's the conflict attributable impact. So we can talk about how many children are dying as a result of the conflict, not as a result of development in general. Or we can talk about the level of indirect mortality, so people not killed directly in fighting, but killed for lack of access to healthcare, food, etc. So that's a broad and quick overview of the methodology. The main finding of this study. Conflict sets back development. We've heard that a lot, but I'm going to show you three graphs that explains a bit more about what that developmental setback looks like. This is a measure of the Human Development Index from 1990 through 2030. The green line represents our no conflict scenario. So this is a world in which conflict did not escalate in 2015 significantly. We expected human development in Yemen to continue improving. However, conflict did escalate. So what we see here is the modeled result of the impact of conflict escalation on the Human Development Index. That conflict escalation sets back human development in Yemen by 21 years to be around the year 2000. If the conflict continues to 2022, that conflict setback accelerates further. So the longer the conflict continues, the faster the developmental setback moves in reverse. If the conflict continues to 2030, we estimate that the developmental setback should be around 4 decades. So a huge and significant impact on development directly from the conflict. I'm going to show some other results. Here are results that are related to mortality. So this is a line graph that shows you two types of mortality associated with the conflict. The blue line is our estimate of direct mortality associated with the conflict through the end of 2019. So how many people are killed directly in fighting or very closely associated with fighting. The red line, and to understand the magnitude of the red line, it's the gap between the blue and the red. The red line represents the indirect mortality figure. So the number of people who have died indirectly as a result of lack of access to health services, food, income, water, sanitation, all of the issues that we're talking about here. Through 2019, the indirect mortality exceeds the direct mortality for the conflict. That's an important thing, I think, for us to be discussing in a public space about the impact of conflict on Yemen. Here's a finding that I think is pretty devastating. It's the father of a young child. The conflict, these are the conflict attributable child deaths associated with the comparing the no conflict and the conflict scenarios. By the end of 2019, we estimate that 140,000 children have died as a result of the conflict. That's both directly and indirectly, but the majority of that child mortality is indirect and not direct. Right? So the result of lack of access to health, food, income, etc. So those are some of the broad findings. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to move into an assessment of the sustainable development goals and how the conflict in Yemen has impacted the ability of Yemen to achieve the sustainable development goals. So for this, we look at 4 goals. I'm going to go through each of those goals and explore how the conflict has impacted development. SDG 1, no poverty. The poverty level, and I'm showing you the extreme poverty level. There are normally 2 general poverty thresholds, extreme poverty and poverty, and the poverty threshold is a bit higher, right? This is the extreme poverty threshold. I'll talk about another poverty measure, the poverty gap, in a moment as well. But in 2014, the percent of the population in extreme poverty was close to 1 in 5, about 20%. In a world without conflict, and I'm showing you the results from the no conflict world, we expected that situation to improve, but not improve dramatically or immediately. In a world without conflict, Yemen remained fragile. It had fragile institutions. It had fragile development across multiple issue areas. We projected in this scenario that Yemen would reduce the share of the population in extreme poverty by 2019 to about where it was in 2014, and then by 2022, reducing it a bit more. And by 2030, in a development scenario like this, it would be about a third of what it was in 2014. However, the conflict did escalate. So comparing the conflict escalation to the no conflict scenario, right? What the conflict did was it increased the number of people, the percentage point share of the population in extreme poverty by 40% of the total population. That is what this, as the conflict continues, we expect to increase. The longer the conflict persists, the faster development is set in reverse, and the greater the broad-based impacts are on sustainable development goals, and obviously, more importantly, human development and human well-being. As the second thing that we explored for each of the SDGs, we looked at where Yemen ranks in a global in the global community across all of these indicators. So for this graph, this looks at 186 countries. So if you're all the way at the tippy top, 186, you are the lowest ranked country for this indicator, right? Or you have the greatest ranking for something like the poverty gap. If you're all the way at zero, that means you're doing the best. So before the conflict, Yemen had a poor ranking for extreme poverty, but what the conflict has done is it's increased Yemen's ranking so that today, in 2019, Yemen is one of the countries with the largest share of the population under the extreme poverty threshold, but it's compounded even more because the poverty gap, which is the distance between your poverty threshold and where people actually are. So if you have 10% of the population living on less than $1.90 a day, they can be living on $1.89, or they can be living on 10 cents. The further they're to 10 cents, the greater your poverty gap is. Yemen's poverty gap has soared over the past 5 years, based on our estimates. And the poverty gap measure, plus the share of the population in extreme poverty, plus issues like extreme impacts on reducing GDP per capita and increasing income inequality, I'll get to that in a moment. Those all paint a picture of a country that, as the conflict continues, Yemen is poised to be the poorest country in the world. SDG 2, zero hunger. So the conflict has had huge impacts on exacerbating a poor food security situation in Yemen. Prior to the conflict, though, 42% of children were malnourished. In a scenario where there was no conflict escalation in 2015, we expected that to reduce across time, though not to be eliminated. The development scenario we're comparing against without conflict is not some panacea. It's not some magical world where everything gets perfect and better. We're projecting that if conflict hadn't escalated, 42% of the child population would be reduced to 24% by 2030 over that 15-year period, not achieving the SDG. And obviously, I didn't say this earlier, but the poverty SDG is not achieved either. Conflict escalation, however, has absolutely decimated food security systems in Yemen. Yemen's large dependence on outside food imports is just kind of adding fuel to the fire in this kind of a situation. We are projecting that today over 50% of children are malnourished, and as the conflict continues, the share of malnourished kids grows. Malnourished children grows across time, right? This is a preventable conflict. This is again looking at the country ranking. So if you're at the very tippy top, you have the poorest ranking in the world. Today we estimate that Yemen has the lowest average calories per capita of any country in the world. It's not a result that we've highlighted a lot in some of the things we've prepared for this launch, but I think it's a hugely important result for us to consider. The lowest average calories per capita in any country in the world, and the second highest level of childhood severe acute malnutrition, second to South Sudan. The third SDG that we explored is work and economic growth, another complicated issue where the conflict has had a significant impact. We unpack this in a lot of ways in the report, so I encourage you to read both reports as you're able. But this is the impact on GDP per capita at purchasing power parity. So in 2014, we estimate GDP per capita purchasing power parity at 3,800. In a no-conflict scenario, this increases to 4,000, 4,300, and 5,900 across time. So generally increasing, but not coming close to doubling yet. In the conflict scenario, this is reduced significantly as well. So cut by about a third by 2030. These ranking graphs, again, show Yemen's ranking before the conflict escalated and then the impact of conflict escalation. GDP per capita, it does not rank as the poorest in the world, though it has been dropping in its ranking significantly. And Yemen has had the second largest any country in the world since 2014. So huge impact on the economy. Inequalities, the final SDG I'll speak about, and then I'll show some of our summary findings, and then that's all from me. Inequality. We looked at two broad types of inequality, gender-based development inequalities and income inequalities. I'm going to start with the income inequalities. This is the income distribution in Yemen prior to conflict escalation. So the horizontal axis are levels of income. The further to the right, the wealthier you are. And then the vertical axis is the share of the population living on each of those income thresholds. So this is 2014. If we move forward to 2019, this is in a scenario without conflict. The income situation improves slightly, though not massively. Moving forward to 22, there's again a slight improvement. And to 2030, the improvements start to extend. There's a rising middle class in Yemen that emerges in this scenario in a very noticeable way over time. Let's compare this income distribution, where it's improving, with one where conflict escalated. This is the same income distribution in the conflict escalation scenario, but I have to increase the vertical axis in order to fit the bottoming out of the income distribution. 2019, it starts to significantly bottom out, 2022, 2030. This is all associated with massive increases in the poverty gap, a giant increase in the income for the bottom of the population, but also a war economy that drives increases in wealth at the top end as well. So rising inequalities in Yemen. This is again rankings. So Yemen started in 2014 as a middle of the road type of income equality country, but it's completely changed its position across time. Today, we estimate it to be the second most unequal country in the world, and if the conflict continues, it becomes the most unequal country very soon. Looking at alternative pathways to development. So, what if during the conflict we're able to invest more in different sectors? What if we're able to change the development trajectory significantly? What we did is we created four scenarios. So, what if we increase household consumption significantly? What if we improve food distribution? What if we increase access to water and sanitation and targeted child malnutrition? I'm going to show you these on this graph. Okay? I'm going to explain it very quickly. The horizontal axis is time. The vertical axis is your percent achievement of a broad basket of human development-related SDGs. So if you're in the top right, you've achieved all of your human development SDGs. This is the no-conflict scenario. Yemen achieves about 45%. It's about 45% of the way there. And then this is the conflict scenario. It's reduced the ability of Yemen to achieve the SDGs broadly by about 60-70% backwards in the wrong direction. But what if we increase food distribution? Well, that slightly changes how much Yemen is set back. What if we increase household consumption? It has a similar impact. What if we improve targeted child malnutrition reductions? It has also a similar impact. And what if we improve water and sanitation? Something the administrator identified in his comments, that has an even bigger impact on reducing the reversal of human development. But there is only one scenario where you actually change the development trajectory back and you get to be making progress towards achieving the SDGs, and that is the no-conflict scenario. So if the conflict ends in 2019, Yemen will start to make progress towards achieving the SDGs, but only getting back to levels that they saw in 2014 by about 2030. My final slide, very briefly. The war in Yemen has been devastating. It's already set back development 21 years, and a child under 5 dies every 12 minutes because of the conflict. It's greatly increased extreme poverty, reduced caloric availability, destroyed the economy, increased income inequality, and worsened gender inequality. Yemen, before the conflict, was ranked second. It's now second, but on its way to the poorest ranking in gender inequality. International assistance can do so much. The only way to turn development progress around again is to end the conflict. Thank you.
Sense it's my honor to invite Foreign Minister Yemen, Mohammed Al-Hadrami, to speak. let's end the war. I think that's a really strong message. And I'm not sure if all of you know what Yemen is, but it's really difficult for all of us to see where our country, our beloved country, has come to. I mean, you've seen the video before. Seen the beautiful Sana'a city, which I'm from, and how beautiful it is. But let me tell you something. Yemen is not what you see in the news. It's not that bloody war and mines and tragic, horrible pictures of children and poor people. Yemen is full of treasure. It's really rich, not in money or oil, but with the history, with people. I mean, you can see Sana'a City, which is one of the most beautiful cities in the world. Not because it's my city. You can ask those who went there. We have skyscrapers of the deserts. You probably never heard of those. It's in Hadramaut. Been there for hundreds of years before Chicago or even Manhattan. We have Socotra. That's a treasure in itself. An isolated island for millions and millions of years. It's actually a sister of continent, but a little one. It's got many treasures of so many biodiversities and plants. I mean, the dragon blood tree. That would make the Game of Thrones something else. I mean, it's magical. And it really, really touches our heart to see our country like this. But let me touch a few questions. I mean, I have a prepared speech about the report, but let's not worry about that now. I mean, let's end the war. I was a deputy chief of mission in Washington, D.C. when some of this was started two years ago. And a lot of people come to us and say, well, just end the war. End this bloody war. End the coalition. And we tell them, you know, I mean, the pundits, not just regular people, you know, you take a true statement that says, if the war ends, the coalition would end, which is our brothers. That's a true statement. But then you go through this logical fallacy and affirming the consequent by saying, superficially, well, if that's true, if ending the war would actually end the coalition, let's end the coalition so we can end the war. I wish it is that easy. It is not. If we end the coalition now, Yemen will just descend into more destruction, to more chaos, and it would be a bigger problem for the world and for us to handle. We're doing everything we can to fix it, and we need your support. So let me get back to my speech now. Well, you know, until 2014, the government of Yemen has been really trying so hard. I know what you hear in the report, to do a lot of progress in maintaining or in reaching the Millennium Development Goals, even though Yemen was not even going to do so. But that was really hard for us, and we did so many things we can. And when this happened in 2014, it all just dragged and actually stopped. You know, the conflict crippled the government, institutions, and limited our ability to even disperse salaries. But eventually, we did. Eventually, with the help of our partners, we were able to do 65%, 63%. And that was something not easy to do. You know, in spite of the potential circumstances for which we operate, and we had in Aden before a month, the government had released the first physical budget, and that was really not an easy thing to do since the beginning of the violent war in 2014. Further, the government of Yemen has also introduced several measures and mechanisms to aim at halting the economy deterioration. One of them was establishing the Economic Committee that made a lot of decisions, not popular ones, but the right ones. You probably hear of 75 decree, and I know you know all about 49 one as well, but these are really extremely important ones that we need to put to cut all the supplies for the Houthis, to cut the smuggling through Hodeidah, to do a lot of right things. You need to do a lot of unpopular things. People don't understand that. You just see the results, but you don't know what's behind them, and that's really hard to do. I'm not going to go into history, but you know, if this great country hadn't really taken unpopular decision back in 1865, where unpopular president made, you wouldn't see him, you know, in Washington D.C. now on his throne. I'm just saying, you know, in retrospect, it's easy to criticize. But when you're in your hands, you're holding the future of your country, and you see what consequences that you'll be able to make, it is really hard decisions. We thank the UNDP for all the work you're doing. We need all the help we can get. And we're really grateful for our brothers, especially the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, which yesterday just signed a check for $500 million to get things working. And that's something. And it needs to be noted. They're there to help us, and we appreciate that. I think I'm going to end here. And if you need to know more about Yemen, please ask the Yemeni people. I thank you.
Went off script and spoke as you did from the heart. I also have visited Yemen and can say that just before the war, I found it to be a country of both physical treasures and treasures in its people, just as you said. Thank you for your comment. I'd like to now ask our members of the panel to discuss, to start to make their way up to the... To ask members of the panel to make their way up to the stage, and we'll just go over the objectives. So, I have three objectives that are given here. Two, in accordance with the 2030 agenda, how to ensure that Yemenis are not left behind, the importance of development action to resilience building, alongside political and humanitarian components, and the importance of strong partnerships in advancing the humanitarian development peace nexus. But you know, I'm going to give a fourth question to the panelists based on what we just heard, which is, when we look at the sort of analysis that was just presented, and we see that no matter how hard we work on linking up humanitarian development institutional programs, the thing that will really protect the Yemeni people is stopping the war. An additional question, in addition to what I know is being done very creatively to mitigate the impact, how could we use the different tools that we have at our disposal, whether they are political, whether they are economic, whether they are social, to put pressure to actually end the war? It's my pleasure in that context to invite Lise Grande to kick us off. Lise is someone who I think I met 20 years ago, either in DRC or Timor-Leste. Yeah. She has served since then in South Sudan, in Iraq, in many other of the world's most troubled countries, where she has brought always great passion to her work and great creativity and stabilization initiatives. Lise.
Sarah, thank you. I'd like to start by paying my respects to all of the colleagues on the panel, to thank the foreign minister, to thank Akeem, and to thank the German ambassador for bringing this all together, and for their introductory comments. I was asked to start off the panel by reflecting on the humanitarian crisis. You know, the UN characterizes what's happening in Yemen as the worst crisis in the world. And when we say it not only because a higher percentage of aren't impacted, but the depth or the severity of the crisis is unprecedented. If you look at other crises globally, 80% of the entire population in Yemen depends upon the United Nations and our partners for some form of assistance and protection. There is no other country in the world where a higher percentage of the population has nowhere else to turn. The country that we come closest, less than 40% of the population in South Africa, and it's literally double in the case of Yemen. When you talk about the depth and the breadth of the crisis, humanitarians have taken to describing this as you make a leap into the nearly unimaginable. So there are 30 million people in Yemen. Every day, 20 million Yemenis wake up and they're hungry. 10 million UN history, including the Food for Oil program. 130,000 metric tons of food is moved every single month throughout the country to reach 10 million people. As I said, there are 20 million people who are hungry. We're feeding 12 million of them. 8 million people make just enough income to buy what they need on the market. Every time the real, the value appreciates, literally tens of thousands of families can't afford to buy what they need. They come knocking on WFP's door, asking for food. The largest scale-up in UN humanitarian history happened a year and a half ago when WFP was feeding about 2.8 million people a month. Within 1 year, they expanded to 10 million people and now have expanded to 12.4 million. They did that because millions of people in Yemen had absolutely no other way of feeding themselves if it wasn't the World Food Program and the UN partners. You know, the scope of the war, and this is something that Dr. Moy touched on. If you do an infographic of how many front lines there were in 2013, there were two. In 2016, a year later, there were seven. In 2017, there were 11 front lines. Right now, there are 32 active front lines across the country. 32 impacting 10 governments. There's probably no other war right now in the world where there are 32 active front lines. Dr. Moyer also talked about the number of casualties, at least 100,000 combat deaths, 130,000 deaths due to indirect causes. Yeah, every day or every week, there are at least 100 civilian casualties. Half of all of those are women and children. I think probably the most heartbreaking statistic is that of all the children who are dying as a result of the war, almost half of them are malnourished. They said a leap into the unimaginable. The worst famine in living memory is threatening Yemen. Mark Lowcock, who is the UN's Emergency Relief Coordinator, frequently addresses the Security Council once a month. He goes in front of the council and he describes what's happening in Yemen. And one of his most memorable quotes, he's standing in front of the prominent members of the council, one of the 10 elected members, and he makes the point that we will have seen nothing in any of our professional lives that matches the food crisis in Yemen. It's not a production crisis. There's enough food in the country. It's an income famine. Hundreds of thousands, millions of families don't have enough money to buy the things that they need in order to survive. And that points to a deeply uncomfortable fact about what's happening in Yemen. There are two wars in Yemen. There's a war with arms and ammunition, and there's an economic war. Policies that belligerents have adopted has brought that country to the brink of famine. The way that the currency is handled, the way that credit is managed, the restrictions on imports, the restrictions on movements, you add all that up and that's what's driven Yemen to the brink of a famine. But as Mark Lowcock has said to the Security Council, we will have seen nothing like it in any other country in living memory. Yemen, of course, is also a country that had the worst cholera outbreak in modern history. I know everyone knows this. We started keeping records on these kinds of epidemics in the French Revolution. So since 1791, the worst cholera outbreak in modern history in Yemen. A year ago, because of the work of UNICEF, the World Health Organization, transmission was stopped. We went from a million cases 2 years ago to about 350,000 cases last year. This year, the epidemic is out of control. Again, all of the parties to the conflict, all of them, strikes and attacks have occurred on schools and health facilities and other forms of civilian infrastructure, which under international humanitarian law are supposed to be protected. 3.5 million people have been displaced from their homes. I want to talk about, I was asked to say something positive. I'm going to make two final points here. The humanitarian operation in Yemen is the largest in the world by far. I already mentioned what the World Food Program does every single month. They feed 12.4 million people. 10 million people receive healthcare from WHO, UNICEF, and its partners. There are 1,200 cholera treatment centers across the country run by humanitarian partners. There are millions of children and women who are receiving nutrition supplements from WFP, UNICEF, and their partners. Hundreds of thousands of families receive emergency kits and rental support. UNICEF, with World Bank funding, is reaching 9 million people with emergency cash transfers. There are 1,000 rapid response sanitation teams that as soon as someone has cholera and presents themselves at the health post, within hours, those teams are at those locations where they live, building sanitation buffers to try and stop transmission. 1,000 of those teams. UNDP is putting hundreds of thousands of people to work on public schemes. FAO is single-handedly keeping the entire dairy industry alive. IOM is helping migrants, including those who are being detained, for no other reason than they are foreigners. UNHCR is assisting in protecting 250,000 refugees. For the first time in an emergency operation anywhere in the world, UNICEF has taken over the teacher's payroll in northern Yemen and is providing allowances for more than 100,000 teachers so that the schools can remain open and kids can keep going to school. UNFPA is supporting 20 safe houses for women and girls who are the victims of sexual and gender-based violence. There are 200 frontline partners that are working with the United Nations on all of these services. 90% of all the people who work for humanitarian agencies are Yemenis. They're in the forefront of keeping their country safe and looking after the people who are the victims of this war. Final positive point. I know everyone knows this, but typically what happens in a humanitarian operation is that we rush into a country and we create substitute parallel systems of delivery and institutions. We all know these systems and institutions that we create are inefficient, ineffective, and tend to have very little impact. Because of a very innovative, brave decision that the World Bank took, that's not happening in Yemen. Instead, 80% of all humanitarian assistance is delivered through national institutions and ministries. We do that with World Bank IDA funding. More than $1 billion a year of humanitarian assistance is going through those national institutions. So rather than those institutions collapsing, they continue to be effective, they continue to deliver services. When this war is over, we pray soon, the recovery process that Dr. Moyer has talked about and emphasized its importance will hopefully be an accelerated process, unlike in many other countries.
Thank you, Lise, both for some of the incredibly striking facts that you gave, 32 front lines, the worst food crisis in our professional history, the worst outbreak of cholera since the French Revolution, but also for saying something about what has been done in a very innovative way to try to preserve local Yemeni capacity and ability to deliver, which I think will be a good lead-in both to Omar Abdi, Deputy Executive Director for UNICEF, to talk about his programs, and later to Annette. Omar.
Thank you, Sarah. I think this study is very good. If the analysis do not convince Yemenis to end the war, then nothing else would convince, I think. So you've done very well. And I say that I'm from Somalia, a country that's also destroyed. Somalis have destroyed their own country as well. So probably a similar analysis may have helped them. But thank you for that, and at least I think it gave us an overview of what is happening on the ground. But as I was coming here, I was thinking of what could I add to that study, that analysis, and the realities on the ground that will be given by the team from Yemen. And I thought I should mention two invisible impacts of the war. We have seen the death and the destruction and so on. But the impact of the trauma on children, the mental health consequences of what is happening is not just what's affecting children today, but it is going to have a long-term effect. And it's something that we will need to include in our reconstruction recovery program when we get that stage. A recent study, for example, in Sana'a, displaced camps, looked at the students and found that nearly 80% of them, those that were assessed, displayed severe forms of post-traumatic stress syndromes, having negative impacts on their cognitive development, the socio-emotional development, as well as their psychological development in general. The second one that I would raise is we've talked about malnutrition, and when we talk about malnutrition, usually we think of the severe acute malnutrition, which is the wasting that kills children immediately, the one that requires that you treat, and if you don't treat, the kids die. But one in two children in Yemen today suffer from chronic malnutrition, what we call stunting. And that may not kill them today, but it has a longer term effect. Particularly for the first 1,000 days of children, if they face this chronic malnutrition, which is as a result of inadequate and nutritious food, it affects their brain development. It has shown that children that suffer from stunting when they are very young have a lasting effect in their life. Their IQ will be lower, their intellectual capacity will be lower, and it's estimated that even it will have a 20% reduction of their productivity. So as we think about the impact of the war, it's not just what we see on the surface, but what we don't see, which is the brains of children that are being affected.
Thank you, Omar, and I think that's absolutely right, that the invisible effects that you see, particularly the trauma on children, is incredibly hard to reverse. Also, for drawing attention to your personal experience of your own country, people forget that Somalia was a middle-income country before the war in Somalia, and it is very easy to destroy. Annette, I'd like to turn to you. Annette Dixon, Vice President for Human Development at the World Bank. And as Lise has already said, Yemen, in one spark of hope in a very bad situation, has seen very close cooperation between the World Bank and the UN in helping the government and Yemeni institutions to do.
Great. Well, thanks. Thanks very much. You know, it's hard to know what to say after these presentations, but I want to just try and explain the approach that the World Bank is taking in partnership with the government of Yemen and with our UN partners. And it's important because when we talk about the nexus between humanitarian crises, insecurity and conflict and development, I think Yemen is an extreme example of how the world has changed, but more importantly, how the development agencies need to change to meet the challenge. When I joined the bank 20 years ago, we had a very linear approach to development engagement in situations in conflict. We didn't engage until a peace agreement was signed and sealed, bombs had stopped dropping, and situations had stabilized. And we then went in, of course, and tried to help the emerging processes that come in that post-conflict period. And I guess about a decade ago, in part due to the work that Sarah and others did in the bank in that time, we really started to understand we needed to change this process and to really see the interaction between development and insecurity and conflict and humanitarian crises, because the cost of not maintaining a development approach was too high. And in fact, development can actually play a critical role in helping to secure peace and to alleviating some of the impacts of humanitarian crises. And so that's the approach that the bank has been taking in Yemen, which is very different than we would have in the past. Our approach has been to continue to try and support basic service delivery and to preserve institutions, because institutions are really important for securing trust, improving governance, and so on. And of course, we also understand that trying to help improve sources of livelihoods and to secure human capital and basic economic recovery is not only important for that current generation, but it actually is critical for future generations. So IDA, the Fund for the Poorest Countries, has stayed engaged and has been trying to actually help maintain services and, as Lee said, preserve institutions. Some of the projects that are in the portfolio that exemplify this approach are the Emergency Crisis Response Project, which is providing social protection to the poorest and most vulnerable households. And it works through two national institutions, the Social Fund for Development and the Public Works Project. And the second project is the one that Omar talked about, which is the Emergency Health and Nutrition Project, which is helping to continue support for basic health, essential nutrition, water, sanitation. And these projects are actually, in the case of the Health and Nutrition Project, is implemented in partnership with UNICEF, WHO, and the World Food Programme. And I think these exemplify the kinds of partnerships and approaches that we really want to try and continue. Now, I want to make just a couple of points. Firstly, these projects are the result of more than a couple of decades of engagement in Yemen. You know, we weren't able to do this from the get-go. We were able to do this because we've had 2 decades of really close engagement with the Yemenis in building human capital and health and social protection. And so the design of our support in partnership with agencies really built on the lessons of the past. The second is that these are to the extent that we've been able to contribute is only because of the partnerships that we have with the UN, the rest of the UN system. We work closely with UNDP, UNICEF, UNOPS, WHO, FAO, etc. And we have a seamless team in that approach. The project's coverage is nationwide and really is trying to take a longer-term perspective as well as responding to the immediate crisis. And above all, we are trying to preserve and support local institutions, as Lee said. And so I think that this really, for the bank, is a turning point in the way that we engage in these situations. And I think, sadly, as I was being here for the last week, talking with colleagues in the UN system. Sadly, I think the lessons from Yemen will continue to be applied in other conflict situations. Going forward, we want to not only continue IDA's support, IDA is the Fund for the Poorest Countries, We have been able to do what we're doing because the donors of AIDA have actually been supporting us to scale up our work in conflict and fragile countries, but also because we've been able to work with all of our colleagues across the bank to reallocate additional resources to Yemen, and we will keep doing so. And the next project that we will do as soon as we can reallocate resources will be in education. So we will continue to stay engaged. The human tragedy in Yemen is at, I guess, an unprecedented level. And we will continue to stay engaged as a long-term partner. Thank you.
Thank you, Annette. I certainly think that from my time at the World Bank, it would not have been imaginable that World Bank would have continued providing finance to international institutions in partnership with the UN for social protection and health and nutrition right in the middle of an active conflict. So this is something that has brought something. I also think what you said about institutions is very crucial, that institutions are fast to dismantle and very slow to rebuild. We see many countries around the world now whose societies are perhaps rather recklessly dismantling some of their institutions. Preserving them is very important. Turning now to Tauke Lutzmer, resident representative in Sam.
Thank you, Sarah, and good afternoon, everyone. Actually, Liz and I are the ones who live this every day in Sana'a. And I just want to confirm, first of all, also what the minister said. You know, Sana'a, Yemen in general, is absolutely beautiful. Not to the extent we have depressed you collectively here. You know, I wish to assure you it is a pleasure to serve in Yemen, despite all the difficulties that we go through together with the Yemeni people. Now, a lot of them have said already, so I want to keep really short, but I want to maybe start off with a bit of a personal story. My father is now 78 years old. His birthday is on the 2nd of September, so it's recently. Of course, I never made it. You know, it's one of those things in life that we face. I'm his firstborn son, and he knows I'm working in Yemen and on Yemen. And he follows the news to the extent possible. You know, actually, the Dutch newspapers, you don't find much about Yemen, but he tries. And he's always asking me, you know, why don't I solve the problem of Yemen so I can come home? Well, I always have difficulty explaining why that is a bit of a tall order, you know, and how, you know, essentially I fail to explain why I can't do it. I think the testimony of many of us today, and especially Jonathan when he was up there, showed you it is indeed a tall order. Now, Elise explained why Yemen is in the worst humanitarian crisis in the world, and what usually doesn't get, you know, enough highlighted is also the worst development crisis in the world. I think it's equally important to say that as well, and I think the report as such does a good job of explaining that. That doesn't mean that, you know, the base was already low in the sense that we knew even before the war ever started or escalated, because Yemen was not on a trajectory that it would meet the SDGs by 2030, but at least as we were showing, it was a positive trajectory somehow. Now, I want to explain the rationale why we actually started to do this series. We knew the war made it worse. I mean, it's visible for anybody who can see. The question was how much worse it was really going to be, right? And to demonstrate that, we wanted to use it as an advocacy tool for the policymakers, the politicians, whoever wants to listen, to use this as a way to explain, you know, if you stop fighting now, you still have a country to govern. If you continue fighting, you may end up with a country that is no longer, you know, something that is even worthwhile fighting over in the first place. So this is kind of where we started the discussion with Pardi. And I thank Jonathan for an excellent presentation today. To understand more about, you know, what is the real impact of the conflict on development in Yemen. And I think we've seen the figures, right? it is sunk deep in a vicious cycle of disease, poverty, inequality, and hunger. And as we all now know, first report set it out very clearly, 4 years of war set back development for 20 years. I mean, I think it's a very powerful statement here. So, as it stands and as the board has indicated, Yemen will not achieve the sustainable goal for 2030. And instead, because of the conflict, we're looking at the country achieving them only in 2061. If you go by the current trajectory, 2061. I mean, that's unbelievable, right? And it is really falling short of our commitment to leave nobody behind. We're seeing economic losses of GDP in the billions, and GDP per capita raised from the 1960s. We see the gender imbalances growing, as Jonathan was referring to. And you see that basic infrastructure that once existed in Yemen is now destroyed. Mm-hmm. Only half of the hospitals are functioning right now, and sanitation and water facilities have been devastated. As explained, you know, an overwhelming majority of Yemenis will live in poverty, with the worst death of poverty globally, and the population will be overwhelmingly malnourished. The economy will fundamentally deteriorate, and we showed already that GDP per capita is now ranking among the lowest in the world. I think also UNICEF referred to this. Children are disproportionately affected by the conflict. The report actually estimates that 1 in 5 Yemenis will be stunted, and that of course will represent a huge burden, not only on any future government, but also on generations to come. Something that I always think about is, you know, this population of Yemen is set to double by 2035 to 50 million people, given the high birth rate that exists in Yemen. Mm. 50 million people. Whilst at the same time, the social basic infrastructure is being destroyed on a daily basis. How do we support a population of that size by 2035? It's a huge question, I think, for all to think about. As UNDP, we play, of course, somewhat of a unique role in the sense that we are, you know, a development agency in a huge crisis, right? I'm going to go quick, sorry. And basically, we work also in the nexus that Achim was talking about early on. Let me just move on then and finish up. I want to talk about coffee for 1 minute. You've seen this box, right? It's not valiant for your depression. This is really coffee. Coffee that I want you to take home. And when you open it and you drink, because this is premium export coffee, that you think about Yemen, and you think about, you know, what you can do to end this war and move it forward. This bag of coffee also represents, I believe, what the development stands for in Yemen. It also stands for the resilience and the dignity of Yemen, because somehow this coffee still finds its way on the international market. Right? So finally, an appeal to you. I want you to help me to do my father proud. Help us, you know, to end the war in Yemen and give Yemeni generations a chance. Give me a chance to go home and tell my dad I solved it.
Thank you everyone for being here and thank you for UNDP for and also to lower the cost for everyone else involved in the war and also in development in the world. So I have to say that the findings of the study portray an image bleaker than what I had imagined. And this comes from me, who has been recently to Yemen, and I have seen the devastation in the country, in every corner of the country, not only a physical devastation, but also a, you can say, an economic one, and also a psychological one, which has its own cost that maybe we cannot quantify right now, but also mentioning the toll on children and their intellectual growth. These long-term effects will come and haunt us in the future. So again, it cannot be said enough that ending the war today before tomorrow will be for the best for everyone. So I know that the focus of the two reports is somehow limited due to, for the sake of clarity, and also due to lack of data that cannot be collected because of obstructions from different war parties who are, of course, scared of creating knowledge about the war in terms of wanting to serve their own interest in prolonging the war, and having this knowledge that can help stakeholders and people in power end the war. This knowledge is scared of the warring parties. So, in terms of the report findings, I would have been interested in seeing more focus on the impact of the war on historically marginalized groups in the country, some groups in the population, such as women and also dark-skinned people who are called the Muhammashin in the country. The war took its toll on women, whether they were working women or not. We have seen that working women were laid off their jobs to protect the jobs of their male peers, because under the pretext that male workers have families to feed, like women. Also, we have seen that almost half of the IDP households have women as their sole breadwinner. Also, the war forced many women into low-paying jobs, leaving them subject to exploitation in the labor market. Of course, this is not exclusive to women in the country, but it is highly disturbing for me to see some reports, luckily not this one, celebrate this engagement of women in the labor market and exploitative labor market as an empowerment in the country in such circumstances. So I believe that women's participation in the labor market is very vital for development, but can only support human development if we can guarantee decent work for everybody. Also, the Muhammashin are a historically marginalized group in the country that has worked in unskilled and low-paying jobs, and they have been also really hit by the loss of purchasing power in the country with the depreciation of the Yemeni riyal, leaving them at risk of sinking into extreme poverty and suffering from malnutrition and hunger. Also, the recurrent changes in the leadership of the Yemeni Central Bank leaves little room for every new leadership and for stakeholders to implement sound monetary policies to restore this purchasing power that is most needed to fight the famine in the country. As you have said, it's an income famine. It's not a lack of food, it's the decreasing purchasing power in the country that is causing a lot of people to suffer from famine. On another note, the report also touches on the very important issue of Yemeni returnees, or Yemenis who are being right now, nowadays, deported from Saudi Arabia due to its Saudi 2030 economic vision that works on increasing the share of Saudis in the private sector, Saudi nationals as far as the private sector in the kingdom, which will have tremendous effects on the already high levels of poverty in Yemen. It is estimated that we have currently almost 1 million Yemenis working in Saudi Arabia, and the remittances they send back home amount to billions of dollars annually, and they support millions of family members in the country. It's not, what they send back home is not just in the country since oil exports has been stopped in 2015. So this means that these remittances have been a factor in preventing a further deterioration of the situation with the Yemeni riyal, with it being the main cause, as we have mentioned before, for the famine right now, and even people not being being able to afford food in the country. So, if the majority of workers in Yemeni workers in Saudi Arabia are being forced to leave Saudi Arabia, we have estimated, according to our estimates in the Sana'a Center, that almost 70% of those Yemenis will lose their jobs by 2020, that's next year. So you can imagine the toll that it will have on the country having so many people return at once. So however terrible the situation in Yemen now, forcing those workers to come back home will have long-term negative effects on employment, income, and also the status of infrastructure in the country. And also regarding the pathways of development, I kind of have wished that to see more sophisticated development pathways, but I can totally understand and totally agree with you that these pathways are the most needed right now in Yemen in terms of having like basic necessities provided to the population, food and access to water and sanitation. I believe now that we all have a better sense of the devastating impact of the war on development in the country. But we also know that these implications of the war can be reversed. Okay, I know that the journey is not easy, okay, but it's still possible. But before everything else, we need to stop the war in order to be able to reverse the implications of the war. So I believe that also assistance to the UNDP has never been more important as in these times. And it is also vital for the UNDP and its programs to work without any obstructions from the different world parties. So if you basically cannot end the war now, let people continue their work without many obstacles and the obstruction that will prolong the suffering of the Yemeni people. So and I believe that Yemen is coming.
Government is somehow Minister went out to the economic committee and think they were doing some policies that a lot of people in the board today in the room are not a fan of. They're trying to really mitigate this this effect of the inequality that there are some factions in the conflict who are making a lot of wealth out of the conflict. What has the international community, the UN, or do they have in mind in helping the government actually and reducing this inequality by cutting the benefits from those who are using the suffering people to achieve either political or economic growth?
Thank you. I think it's a very good question. You have, as Lisa said, a war with arms and you have an economic war, and the question of how do you try to stem the profits of those who profit from war is important. Other questions and comments? Please.
Hi, I'm David with the Children, and thanks a lot, Alice, for organizing this event and providing good perspective of the negative impact of conflict in Yemen, and for flagging the disproportionate effect that the conflict is having on children. It's really tragic to see like all of these leaders. I wanted to draw attention to a statement signed on by 24 humanitarian NGOs active in Yemen. I won't talk about it right now, but I'm happy to be copied if colleagues are interested. I just wanted to ask a question to panelists on how can we ensure that historically marginalized groups, as the colleague from the center mentioned, can be part of these discussions on the nexus, on humanitarian development and peace nexus of women, children, youth. How can we be part of these conversations? And hopefully, can we ensure avenues for their voices to be taken into account once the political process can start? A very concrete question about how international and local and humanitarian partners can be part of the coordination on the day-to-day of this. Maybe my colleagues in the country already know that, but just wanted to ask how the coordination works in the country.
Very good, thank you. Other questions or comments from the floor? Just as people are trying to think about this, I'm going to go back to the panel on those first questions. So perhaps first to ask on stemming the profits of war, ask whether perhaps either Annette or Elise would want to comment on that.
Oh, you go first and I'll try and add to what you say.
It was a great question that you asked, and the UN faced, as I'm sure you're aware, a really difficult moral situation just a few months ago. In the areas of northern Yemen where Ansar Allah, the Houthi movement, administers territory, there was clear evidence of diversion of food assistance. For a year, the World Food Program and the UN family engaged with Ansar Allah and said, you got to change the way you're doing this. You cannot keep diverting this assistance. And if you persist, then the UN will take action. So the Houthis said, we don't think that you will take action. Because if you do, you'll be hurting the people who depend on you. And so for 1 year, we kept at them, kept saying, you're diverting assistance. You're not allowed to do that. And then the UN did something that we almost never do anywhere in the world. We stopped assistance. Now, to do that in the middle of a famine, I love when you're talking about your dad. So I have a mother-in-law, and my mother-in-law in Texas, who really struggles, she's been outside of Texas, she really struggles to find anything on map. You know, bless her, she says to me, how could you possibly stop assistance in the middle of a family? And you know, Sarah, at your point, I mean, there was such clarity in that statement, because we did stop assistance in the middle of a famine. We said to Ansar Allah, we're not going to restart this until you stop this diversion and you start to cooperate with the UN in a way which upholds principles. That was an exceptionally difficult thing for us to do. I think it was clear for many of the frontline partners and those of us who are operating in Yemen, it was absolutely the right thing to do. We are in a very similar situation now in northern Yemen, where there are so many obstacles that have been put in the way of humanitarian. We can't move, can't do third-party monitoring, we're not allowed to import the things that we need. There's a list of more than 80 separate rules and regulations that have been issued by the authorities in Sana'a telling us everything we're not allowed to do. Our operating environment has become so non-permissive that we're forced into making the same kinds of decisions that we were forced to make just a few months ago. We do that because the most important thing in a crisis like this is that the people who aren't going to make it without us get that assistance, and it's our collective responsibility to ensure that that happens.
Just, I absolutely agree with what Lisa said. Just to add two things. We also have very strong obligations to all of our stakeholders and donor countries who are part of the cooperative of countries that own the World Bank and who invest in the funds for the poorest countries. And we have a fiduciary obligation to those countries and to their taxpayers to actually stop any leakage from projects that we finance. We actually sadly had to suspend disbursements on one of the projects for about a month. We've managed to restart disbursements this week, and I can tell you that the staff and the UN agencies concerned and World Bank staff worked around the clock to put in place an action plan that plugged these holes. But it's something that is really, really, that's, you know, one of the things that keeps us all awake at night. The other thing that's actually really important, and it's actually a longer term agenda, and it's really part of the peace process, is really trying to actually help secure or resecure assets of a country that have been stolen. And that's something I'm talking more generically, but we do try wherever we can to help countries recover their assets when they have been stolen, and where we can, because they're actually able to be recovered from foreign bank accounts where those countries are actually partnering with an initiative to help return stolen assets to the country of origin so that they can actually be used for the citizens of those countries. Can I try and answer the second? I couldn't quite hear the second question, but I understood it was about how to engage with civil society, is that right?
I think your question was two parts, I understood, how local partners are involved in coordination and delivery and bridging across the humanitarian development.
Yeah, so it was like how traditional marginalized groups like women and children, youth can be part of this process, how can the voice can be part of it, and then specifically humanitarian actors, both local and international, how can be part of the coordination structure?
Yeah, this is a really important question. One of the projects, we're financing about five projects, and in any World Bank financed project, we try to design anywhere in the world, I'm not just talking about Yemen, but citizen engagement and feedback and participation of project beneficiaries. In the labour and community services projects, so these are the cash for work and cash transfer systems, these projects are by design using participatory approaches. So they are actually designed to encourage community collaboration, deepen engagement, and promote social cohesion at the very local level. And as I said earlier, these projects are not only providing critical resources in the face of this human catastrophe in terms of the income crisis that Lise talked about, but we are also trying to contribute to the peace process through building social cohesion and trust. And that's why it's so important to try and preserve the institutions through this conflict.
Thank you. Do you want to come into this question about local actors here? Because, of course, both humanitarian and development programs and the bridge between the two.
Yeah, I also wanted to make a quick comment about the poor economy, but I think it's really important.
increasingly important to understand what this war economy is all about, who is in it, what, how the flows run, and so on and so forth, so that also we have means of dealing with some of these illicit flows of money. Now, this is not an easy thing to do because it's highly political, obviously, but I think, in particular, as part of the work, the special envoy, this is an important component. So I think that the question is very well taken. I think on the question of working in the nexus, I think the point has already been delivered a little bit in the sense, you know, that especially with the World Bank, we're working particularly in that space, you know, where they really try to deal with some of the humanitarian problems but through a development approach. So, for example, when we talk about family response, we are actively part of it because through our public work schemes, you know, we have an enormous amount of beneficiaries who earn an income through the work they do, right? And by our own empirical evidence, it shows that 80% of that income is used for a food basket that they then purchase on the market. So I think this is also, you know, shown as one of the development pathways that comes out of the study. So I think maybe that's actually on the right track, but obviously the needs in Yemen are so incredibly high that, you know, all these programs still need to be expanded if you want to, you know, reach all the
Thank you. Again, I think the point on understanding the political economy of war is also crucial, because if you look at wars that have stayed in place for decades, as was the case in Somalia, this is always because there aren't people interested in spending. Other questions and comments from the group?
Good afternoon. Dominic Allen from UNFPA. Quick story and a comment and a question. I think first, I'd like to give voice to Om Asma from Al Bayda in Yemen. The health facility in her rural area in Al Bayda was unable to manage her delivery. And in her words, she says, "When it was time to give birth, my husband and I went to the district clinic. The clinic wasn't equipped to handle the birth, and my situation started to worsen. The doctor there told me I needed a cesarean section with special care. They do not have the facilities." So she arrived in the Kuwait hospital in Sana'a, the capital, and after many hours of travel, there she underwent a successful C-section. Again, she says, "This saved my life and my child in this hospital." Now, other women are not going to be as fortunate as Om Asma, and of severe funding shortages, which Lisa has talked about in many different environments, are cutting down the support that we can provide to health facilities, many partners as well, like the Al-Kuwait hospital, where emergency obstetric care services are made available through our support and many other partners, like the our civil society and NGO partners. So, I think two comments. One, we have a serious threat to the health of an estimated 6 million childbearing Yemeni women. And I think some of those comments came through from leasing the safe spaces that women and girls face, the unique experiences that they have in Yemen. I think I'm really looking forward to engaging on the report, and congratulations to the report writers, to UNDP for this event, and note our appreciation to Lisa and her leadership on the ground, to Alka, our partners with UNICEF and with UNDP. But I just wanted to go back to panel and ask for any specific thoughts or reflections on the situation for women and girls in Yemen as well.
Thank you very much for the insight into Yemen this evening. I'm Tolu from DCO. My question is in relation to human rights. I know it is challenging just as with development and with the humanitarian, but are there any opportunities to advance on human rights at the current moment? Thank you.
Thank you. To ask for any last questions or comments, then I'll come back to each of the panelists.
Thank you very much. Ali Migali, I'm at the center with Sarah, but I'm also a commissioner on the Syria Commission of Inquiry. I wanted to ask on education, because you touched upon it a little bit, but I wondered how you're measuring the impact of the war on education in Yemen. Because in Syria, we've seen how the war in Syria has really had a tremendous impact on children. And as you say, we're not looking at results now, we're looking at impact in the years to come. My other question was on public sector employment in Yemen, which back in 2014, I think swallowed up, I think, probably 32% of the budget, and has gone up since. And in the way that we're operating in Yemen today, what's being done to try and ameliorate the impact of where a lot of the money is going in Yemen? Thank you.
Thank you very much, honey. Thank you very much. It's maybe not fair to ask from my point of view. I'm the director of the Crisis Bureau in UNDP, and I would like to have some word from the panelists on the what can development do to bring peace. It's all the humanitarian crisis and development crisis as well. What can development partners do to promote peace? It's a very difficult one at this moment, but your insight would be appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you. I think it's a crucial question. Over here on the left.
So my question is actually just stolen. I'm asking Veteran Search for Common Ground, and I also would love to hear how your organizations are approaching efforts to promote locally led peace building in this really devastating complex situation.
Very good. Any last questions? If not, I'm going to perhaps offer the mic first to Jonathan to add anything from the point of view of the authors of the study in relation to those questions. So we have questions on women and girls, human rights, education, public sector employment, and development links to local levels.
Thank you. The impact, the aspects of the impact of the conflict on women and girls that we looked into most were related to what the gender development index, which looks at disparities in development across genders, where Yemen has an incredibly low score. It had a very low score before the conflict. It was had the poorest development index value from a data side. And when we estimate to fill holes, Somalia had a slightly poorer value back in 2014. And the conflict has deteriorated as well. But there are also a lot of gender-related impacts associated with things we can't even measure in a study like the sexual violence during conflict, assaults, the rest. In terms of the question about education, the first study we produced included a more robust kind of treatment of education, and the second study we didn't look at education-related SDGs either. But as a final comment, thank you very much to the panel, thank you very much to the moderator, and thank you all for coming. We were very pleased to be a part of this process because it's so important. So thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan. We are going to go back to the panel over there and their comments. So I'd like perhaps to change around the order a little bit. Of our questions, I think there are two or three that are definitely in your court.
Yeah, let me address the one on education on the panel. The impact on education is equally alarming. We estimate about 2 million children that are out of school. Before the war, there were about 1.4 million children out of school. And that is just the access part of it. The learning crisis is, we haven't measured it, but it is obvious, the quality of the teachers. But despite of all of those things, I think it is important to note, and Annette mentioned this earlier on, the systems are still being held, but very loosely. I think if this continues for how long will teachers be paid by partners? Will health workers be paid by partners? Will systems be held as they are now? So I think there is a small window of opportunity if the war stops it is possible to rebuild the systems quickly. If not, then we will end up like Somalia or South Sudan.
Just a couple of things. Just to add on education, before the war, we know that children in Yemen had, on average, were getting 8 years of schooling out of a possible 14. But their learning outcomes were the equivalent of 4 years of education. So the system was already extremely challenged in terms of learning outcomes. So we can only imagine how much it's deteriorated from there. In terms of the question from the colleague from UNFPA, I think we all understand that in conflict, there is a huge set of issues around gender-based violence. Women are exploited in ways that we know, but I think the extent to which sex is being used as a weapon of war in many conflict situations is just unfathomable to those of us who work in conflict and post-conflict situations. And sadly, it's one of the areas of where the World Bank is increasing our engagement in helping to create the kinds of services that women who've been survivors of gender-based violence and sexual exploitation need. But even more broadly, I think reproductive health services are amongst the first services to really suffer. And the consequence of that is that women lose autonomy, and they lose control over their fertility. And I just happened to be in northern Lebanon earlier this year and spent a morning with a couple of families who are displaced by the Syrian conflict, living in northern Lebanon. And I was with a woman, and when they left Syria, she had three children. And in the space of the 5 years since she left, she had three more children. And I asked her what were her plans with respect to her family, and she said, I need $100 for a device because I really, really don't want any more children. And the UNHCR colleagues who were with us said, you know, there is no country in the world that will take a family with six children. So their future is actually, the entire family is at peril because she's not been able to have direct control over her reproductive health. So I think it speaks to the kind of vulnerability that you described in the case of the woman whose birth was dangerous. What can development do to bring peace? I think firstly, obviously, we talked a lot about trying to preserve institutions and provide services, the conditions under which service delivery works, because citizens only will trust institutions that actually deliver services. But more broadly, I think it's incumbent on those of us who work in development to try and design development programs in a way that promote equality, fairness, and benefit sharing amongst all stakeholders. And that takes a lot of careful thought and design. We all go by do no harm, but beyond that, we can do a lot of good if we get it right.
Thank you, Annette. There were questions on many of the areas that UNDP I know will cover, on human rights, public sector employment, development, to peace.
So many, yeah. But maybe just to on the sort of development for peace, also activities, I think, is also very important. I think it's also very important that, I mean, we do work very closely with Martin Griffiths and his office, right? And I think the work on the quarter of the day was already referenced in the sense that it's not only a question of being a very important part of the importation of humanitarian goods and fuel and food commodities, but it is also a means by which the parties have to work together to make that happen, right? So there is a negotiation part of that that's really important. Similar, I think, also, if you look at, for example, some mostly in the context of preservation of institutions of class. So people usually forget that we talk about Yemen, sort of the whole country in flames, but actually, if you think about it, Yemen is a huge country and it's 32 or 35 kilometers up there, located in a limited geographical area, right? So there is a lot of development work that actually could be done. Now, I have to admit that doing human rights work in Yemen, you know that better than anyone, is probably the most difficult part of the US of the second at the moment, because I think to a large degree things are so politicized. You know, we do have an OHCHR representation in the country, for example, who were a guy that in PNG twice, if not more times, you know. It is difficult in the current environment to really kind of follow through on the human rights agenda, but of course, in terms of the overall rights, every UN agency includes that in its own programming, which is kind of a different angle.
Thank you. So, Lisa, you're president and humanitarian coordinator, so you can deal with everything. Your comments?
I want to take this question about what development partners can do to support the peace process. So Martin Griffiths, who is our very exceptional special envoy, he and I came into the country at the same time. And the first thing Martin said to me is, don't let me down. He said, if the parties agree on something and there's a cost to that, can the UN system please make sure that they back in immediately and provide the funding and support that's necessary. That's the program that Alki is referring to, the work that's being done in UDATA. This was an agreement that was reached in Stockholm between the parties. In order for us to show and demonstrate support for that, immediately UNDP stepped up, starting to repair the port. We started to work in aid and on things that were agreed in Stockholm as well. This is a concrete example of how the UN system, under the reform vision of our Secretary General, has been delivering as one there, and it's been the development partners that have stepped up to make that happen. So UNDP has been, in fact, Martin Griffiths will often say that he thinks that one of the main momentums and engines behind the work that he does is what the development partners are able to help him achieve. On the question of local voices and partners, I want to tell a story about UNICEF and the cluster system. So the humanitarian operation is, like all humanitarian operations globally, coordinated through a cluster system. Most of the cluster coordinators are international staff, but not in the case of education. This is a cluster which is led by UNICEF, and the cluster coordinator was Jamie. Her name was Afghan. And from the moment I met her, the first thing she said is, you know, nobody pays attention to education, and this is a shame. So please, humanitarian coordinator, pay attention to education. And then she said, and I want you to find a way to pay all the teachers. Those of you who know about funding for humanitarian crisis, education never gets any money, and it is inconceivable that we would take over a payroll for the public sector. Every time I saw Afghan, this was about once a week, she would say, have you found a way to pay the teachers? She kept saying it. She kept saying it. She kept insisting. And then she got women's groups who would come in two or three a week and say to the humanitarian coordinator, why aren't you paying the teachers? This kept going. We reached out to the United Arab Emirates, and they said, you know, you're right. We need to pay the teachers. UNICEF had a mechanism in place to take over the entire payroll of teachers in northern Yemen. That was because there was a role for local voices in our coordination structure. They were insistent that we do the right thing, and as a result, the entire way in which education is coordinated in emergency changed because of this. A small example of the way we try and make that happen on human rights. So final story about UNFPA. In northern Yemen, the local authorities decided to stop all sexual and gender-based violence programming because it was culturally inappropriate. So all of the work that was being done was stopped. And this is what the
said to those people, we're not going to open the door until everyone agrees on how we can restart these programs. It took 11 hours. UNFPA had expert leadership and guidance on this. And at the end of the day, everyone agreed that those programs could restart. Now, bravo to the frontline partners who do this kind of work and under impossible and very difficult conditions insist that human rights have to be respected.
Thank you, Denise. And now the last comment from the panelists.
So I have last comments regarding the development and peace in the country. And when we see Yemen, Yemen has been historically poor. Okay, I remember back in the day before the war, we used to explain, for example, the recruitment of Al-Qaeda fighters due to the lack of income for certain groups in the country. And now when you see more people falling into poverty, extreme poverty, okay, you see the level of recruitment for, by the different warring parties going higher and higher. Okay, so I mean, development is very crucial to bringing peace in Yemen in terms of providing jobs or increasing the income of the people and giving people hope and some prospect in their lives. I, like said before, I was in the country and I felt like really sad because I remember back in the day when it was given that you finish school and you think of either going to university or doing some training and thinking of the future. And nowadays, I was struck by the checkpoints of how young the fighters and the checkpoints were. It really breaks my heart to see people without any prospects in their lives. And to have more development in the country, I believe that we play a tremendous role in bringing peace and bringing people some sort of hope for their own future.
Thank you, Emma. I have the almost impossible task of trying to summarize a few messages before I hand over to Murat to close the meeting. I'm going to do it under three categories. The impact of the war, some creative points to mitigate its impact, and the link between development and ending the war, which is what I'll ask about. So first of all, the impact of this is just devastating. No? So I have worked for the last 30 years in countries that are affected by conflict, and this is out of the ballpark for the countries that I have worked in. So if we now have 80% of the population dependent on humanitarian assistance compared to 40 in the nearest conflict, we have 32 front lines, I think we should figure these. Cholera outbreaks at a scale not seen in a couple of centuries, not in a few decades. And as the study said, there are four decades potentially of being put back in development terms if the conflict is not ended. So we have many conflicts around the world, but the impact of this one is out of the headquarters. Second, on creative points of trying to mitigate that impact on the enemy. Here I think all the speakers made some excellent points about this. So we've seen ways to deliver assistance through local institutions. I have not seen that done so comprehensively in other conflicts. I think it's really important. It's a way both of giving some trust and hope, some hope that institutions will not take so long to rebuild when the conflict does end, and a possibility that local institutions continue to deliver to their own population, not that the only sign of hope is the presence of international institutions. Going through local government structures, I think I took that point very strongly. I think that there is almost always a possibility to do much more for local government structures than we believe is possible, adapting that to different areas of the country. And the use of some of the national programs, the social protection, the emergency assistance programs. Last of all, are the links between development and actually ending the war, because I think one of the main messages in this study is that all of these mitigating measures are very, very important, but they don't come close to the prospect of ending the war. So here I think that there are several ideas, perhaps rather than the answers of where those development linkages are. One is certainly what Lisa
Thank you very much, Sarah. And allow me first to thank you for being such a skillful moderator and really for helping to bring out the hope in the midst of this really tragic report. Thank you very much for providing this report. War is hell, you know, but I think in Yemen we have four wars. We have a military conflict that you spoke about in 32 fronts or 35 or many fronts. Even if they're circumscribed, pretty large, it's a real conflict. And we've seen it grow in recent days. There's an economic war that you all spoke so eloquently about. There's a war on the bodies of women that is kind of happening. And again, please, thank you for bringing that up also. Thank you to the colleague from the FBI. And there's a war in the minds of children. And these wars combine, I think, to create a really tragic situation. I hope in UNDP, by supporting these studies, was that we could bring to light some of these issues. But I think the UN is not there to trade in doom. The UN is there to support hope. And to provide hope, even in the worst of the conflicts, and this is a terrible conflict. And I think, Sarah, you brought out some of the areas of hope where we can end on a positive note. And perhaps if I could continue on that vein, I would also really strongly support the reliance on local structures, national institutions, and I think it means you said that 96% of the humanitarian work is in Yemen, are Yemenis themselves. So I think that is something to be noted. And 80% goes to national institutions. I got the numbers right. I think there's a lot of work to be done in supporting the banking system, which at the moment is crumbling, both in the north and in the central bank in Aden. I think there is a lot of support required there. There's some work to be done on locally led peace initiatives, I think. You're absolutely right. There's enormous benefits, I think, to having Yemenis employed abroad and to keep the flow of remittances coming into the country, because, as you've noted, without that, I think the country would really sink into the depths of the economic war. One can hope always to limit the profits of war, although they create such a tragic dilemma for people stopping. And I know how you felt, Lise, when you were doing this. So it's a situation nobody should have to be put in. But stopping the profits of war is important. Recovering stolen assets is what helps possible sometime in the future. But I think I'd like to end with a sentence you had on your PowerPoint, Dr. Moy. International assistance can only do so much. We must end the war.